Hello, today we shall see the concept of blending. Blending is one of the aims of Bloom. So we shall see the details of blending. Raw material characteristics. Before we see blending, we should know what kind of raw material we have. The raw materials used for the manufacture of textile materials are always inhomogeneous in their characteristics. The inhomogeneity is due to the cultivation conditions in case of natural fibers, and also because of different production conditions in case of man-made fibers. So mixing would be a term which is normally used for different grades of same fiber when they are mixed together, whereas blending is used when different fibers of same or different grades are mixed together. To give an example of this would be cotton from two different sources. When they are mixed together, it would be called as a mixing. Whereas if cotton and polyester, which is a natural and a man-made fiber, are mixed together, it is called as blending. So let us go ahead and see what are the reasons for this mixing or blending. So the first reason is homogenization. As we have seen that the raw material comes, whether it is natural or man-made, it comes in a inhomogeneous form. If it is a natural fiber, it will be due to the cultivation conditions. We cannot have any control, and that's why there's a lot of variation. But also in case of man-made fibers, one will see a lot of variation due to the production differences over there. So to compensate for the variation in the characteristics within a particular type of fiber, example, cotton coming from different sources, homogenization is required. The machines that are installed in the Bloom line, if we are looking at a good mixing or a blend, the machines must ensure an homogeneity in the mix. So let us see what are the different other more various reasons why blending is done. So the second reason why blending would be done is for improvement in functional properties. So improvement in functional properties would be the reason would be to get the required end product characteristics. A yarn produced from a single fiber cannot impart all the desired properties to the fabric. So if you are making a fabric out of, say, cotton only, then we may get all the properties of the cotton in the fabric. But if we want some different characteristics, for example, cotton is not is something which after washing needs to be ironed. So in that case, if I want to have that kind of a property where I want to have a wash and wear kind of a fabric, in that case, cotton alone cannot give me that characteristic in the fabric. So I may have to go for a blend. So example, polyester fibers, for example, are moisture resistant, and the addition of cotton to polyester in certain proportions can neutralize the negative effects of polyester. Now, the way cotton has got a disadvantage of it cannot be wash and wear type, in the same way, polyester also has got its disadvantage that they are moisture resistant. So each of these fibers, when mixed together or blended together, tend to neutralize the negative characteristics of each other. In this current example, cotton tends to neutralize the negative characteristics of polyester since cotton is more absorbent towards moisture and also provides comfort to the wearer. So similarly, the poor strength of viscose fibers can be compensated by the addition of stronger polyester fibers in certain percentages. So we have seen the first two reasons, homogenization and improvement in functional properties. Let us go to the third reason, improved process performance. So to improve the processability of fibers by the addition of certain fibers that help the processing, let us see how this is done. Example, 100% polyester is difficult to process, especially at the card, and the addition of cotton or viscose enables smooth working at the card. So for the reasons of improved process performance, sometimes certain fibers are necessary and they are added to the mix. Addition of the longer and finer man-made fibers to cotton influences the spinnability and also the production levels. So sometimes some fibers need to be added to cotton to improve the production levels. So let us go ahead and see what are the other reasons for blending or mixing. We have already seen homogenization, improvement in functional properties, and also improved process performance. So the next reason would be economy. So to reduce the raw material costs, that is by mixing a lower quality material, the prices of the man-made fibers are more stable as compared to natural fibers like cotton, because cotton has to be grown and it will depend on a lot of environmental conditions, what kind of harvest one would get, and therefore the prices would fluctuate a lot. but in case of man-made fibers, they are comparatively more stable. So mixing and blending can be used to reduce the cost of mixing. Example, viscose may be added to cotton to reduce the raw material costs for the production of certain yarns. Viscose being a man-made or a regenerated fiber, addition of this may bring down the material costs. So we have seen up till now four reasons: homogenization, improvement in functional properties, improved process performance, economy, and now we come to the another reason, that is fancy effects and aesthetics. So to achieve certain special effects like colors. For example, different dyed fibers may be blended at the blow room to obtain a variety of color mixtures and shades. This is a picture showing where we are using a white and a colored fiber to get a special effect. Also, the aesthetics or appearance of the fabric may be developed by selecting specific blend components. So these are a few reasons why blending or mixing is done. So blending enables the technician to combine different fibers so that the good qualities are emphasized and the poor qualities of the fibers are minimized. So with these reasons, let us go ahead and see the problems that we face during blending. One of the problem is deblending. Deblending means the separation of the component fibers from the homogeneous mixture and show up in the final product as individual components. So actually it is the opposite of blending. And this may occur during processing. Therefore, maintaining the blend and its proportion up to the yarn stage is as difficult as producing a homogeneous blend. So even if we are successful in producing a homogeneous blend, maintaining the blend right up to the yarn stage is a difficult task. So deblending may occur due to the following reasons. When fibers of different characteristics like length, surface structure, crimp, etc. are mixed together, and therefore they do not exhibit the same cohesive contact with each other. Therefore, during certain processes in blow room, like the rolling action or during drafting in the drafting system or during pneumatic transport, the components migrate, which result in deblending. Fibers tend to move in groups and the homogeneity is lost. So because of a few reasons like rolling and rolling action and drafting, the components may just migrate and the material will get deblended and homogeneity is lost. So let us now learn how to evaluate a blend. How do we assess a blend? A blend must be evaluated in both the longitudinal as well as the transverse directions. Longitudinal blend inhomogeneity, let us understand what this means. Yarn portions exhibit different percentage distribution of the component along the length. For example, if along the length when we check, suppose this part of the yarn shows 50-50% blend of say polyester and cotton, the next adjacent part of the yarn will show 45-55 and again it will show 50-48. So one can see a variation in the blend composition along the length, and this kind of inhomogeneity will lead to stripiness defect in the fabric. So if the yarn exhibits this kind of a defect, then it will lead to another defect in the fabric which will come up in the form of stripiness. So this is not required and it is not wanted. So we would like to have a homogeneous blend. So one of the way to evaluate whether the blending is good enough or not would be to look at the longitudinal blend in homogeneity. And the second would be transverse. Along with longitudinal, even transverse blend inhomogeneity testing is very important. Poorly distributed fibers in the cross section lead to irregularity in the transverse direction and therefore unevenness in the final finished product. So this is how we will look at it. One can see this colored fiber and the white fiber. They are not exactly mixed or blended properly over here when we look at the cross section. The blue fibers tend to form a group on one half of the yarn, whereas the white ones are forming a group in the other half. So this kind of inhomogeneity is also called as a poor blending. And both homogeneity in case of longitudinal as well as transverse direction is required. So this is how we evaluate a particular blend. So what are the methods of evaluating a blend? How do we measure it? In case of man-made and natural fiber blend, one component may be dissolved or differently colored to estimate the blend composition. So to estimate the blend, one easy way is to dissolve a component using chemicals and weigh the two different components and find out the percentage in the blend or the blend proportion. Or another method would be to color them differently and then maybe evaluate them by just looking at them. or there could be some sort of test like chi-square test where one can measure a degree of randomness in the fiber distribution. And this kind of a test was carried out by Copeland and Klein, and they had come up with an index called as the index of blend irregularity, which is in short IBI. So this was the formula that was used by them, where TI was the total number of fibers in the given cross section, WI is the number of fibers of the component W in that particular section, and P is the average fraction of component W for all sections, whereas Q is equal to 1 minus P, and M is the number of sections examined. So what they basically did was they took sections along the length of the yarn and measured the number of fibers in each section and used this formula to come up with the IBI or the index. So IBI, if it has got a value of 1, then the blend is random, while a value greater than 1 indicates less homogeneity. The index would be 0 for a perfect blend. So if we were to get this index number as 0, then we would get a perfect blend. Otherwise, up to a value of 1, it is quite good, it is random, and if it is greater than 1, it indicates lesser homogeneity. So to expand on this, Copeland and Klein, whatever they had developed index of IBI, rather, of blending irregularity, on that, the method developed by them was based on a longitudinal variation, that is in the ratio of number of different fibers in the cross section, as I have just mentioned. So Copeland and Bloch developed another two methods that considered transverse variation. We already have discussed about the importance of both longitudinal as well as transverse homogeneity in the yarn. So these two methods, that is radial and rotational distribution, were developed by Copeland and Bloch, so that even transverse variation was taken into consideration. So radial distribution, it means that the yarn cross section is divided into a number of say concentric circles, usually it is 4, of either equal area or thickness, and this is how it was done. And there was one more way of evaluating this, that was rotational distribution. The yarn cross section is divided into 4 or 6 segments in this manner, and the blend ratio is calculated in each of these cases, whether you are taking radial distribution or you are using rotational distribution for your evaluation. The blend ratio is calculated and plotted as a bar diagram like this. And ideally, this ratio should be the same for all the segments. If we were to plot this, all the sections should have the same proportion of the fibers, whether it is in this manner, the radial or rotational. So all these 4 sections or these 4 sections should show similar proportion of both the fibers that are being used for blending. So with this, we come to something known as uncontrolled and controlled blending. Blending may be classified as controlled and uncontrolled blending. In uncontrolled blending, the components are brought together at random and without a mixing system. For example, bloom and card. There is no system, they are brought together randomly, and there is no control absolutely over the components or the blend ratio or the composition that the final material or the final output of these particular machines would have. In controlled blending, the individual components are supplied to the machine in an ordered fashion and precisely metered. So exactly the individual components are measured and it is controlled, and your final yarn would have more or less the same composition which we are expecting here. So this is the difference between uncontrolled blending and controlled blending. Controlled blending also further can be classified as intermittent mixing, which is done at weighing hopper feeders where components are fed intermittently in batches. Whereas you can have continuous mixing, as in the case of A81 Uniblend, which is a modern machine by Ritter, or a flock blender by a modern machine by Trutzler, or at draw frames. In all three cases, we will find continuous mixing. So controlled blending, as we said, we can classify as intermittent and continuous. So with this, let us look at the types of blending. Mechanically, the blending may be done at the opening stage, drawing stage, etc. There are various stages at which blending can be done. Now, one by one, we shall look into each of these stages, maybe the advantages, disadvantages, and how they are done. So in case of bloom blending, they are classified, further subclassified as ABC, bale mixing, flock mixing, and lap blending. We'll see each one in detail. In case of bale mixing, there are two types. One is bin or feeder mixing or blending, as it is called, or one can have a stack mixing or blending. So first let us look at bale mixing. So blurum blending, under that bale mixing, blending is done at the start of the process. Both natural and man-made fibers exhibit variations in their characteristics, we know that. Bale blending, 60 to 60 bales are opened simultaneously, and bale blending enables maintaining uniform yarn characteristics over several years in spite of variation in the available raw material. So raw material that is available to us, maybe if it is natural like cotton, the characteristics may change over a period of time, over a number of years. But if we have a good bale blending, that is if we are using around 60 bales, 6 to 60 bales are opened simultaneously, and we have been using over a period of years this number of bales in our mix, in that case a little bit of variation in the cotton over a period of years will not be noticeable, and one will be able to maintain uniform yarn characteristics over several years in spite of the variations. So bales must be selected to have similar average values of fiber length, fineness, strength, etc., so as to have some control over the mixing to obtain a favorable blend. Blurum being the first stage of yarn production, the following processes give a good blend in the transverse direction. Since blurum is a first stage, the following process stages like card, draw frame, since they are going to come after blurum, they would help in giving a good blend in the transverse direction as well. The method of blending being uncontrolled, but one must understand that bale mixing, the mixing at bale level, whether it is flock blending or even lap blending, which we shall see, any one of this kind of blending at the blowroom stage is always going to be an uncontrolled one and may result in unsatisfactory blends in the longitudinal direction in case of blends of widely varying fiber characteristics. For example, in case of natural and man-made blends, one would always find a longitudinal or a longitudinal direction. In the longitudinal direction, the blending would be quite unsatisfactory. So due to the subsequent rolling and drafting in the processes that follow, there is always a danger of de-blending. So another danger is there, that because we are blending at the blowroom stage, there is a danger that due to the rolling action throughout the blowroom machines and also during drafting in draw frame and further drafting systems in maybe roving frame or even ring frame, there is a danger of de-blending, which we have seen. That means the components might separate out. So with this, let us come to the first type, that is bin or feeder mixing or blending. So in this method, the blends are prepared by feeding different fibers to different hopper feeders with feeds adjusted to the required blend ratio. The blend components on bale or bale opener, which is a pre-opened material, are weighed and laid down. A separate blender can be allotted for feeding the recovered fiber waste if required. The amount taken from each bale for feeding these machines must not exceed 2 to 3 kgs. So what is done here is the material is opened out initially by maybe a bale opener or a bale breaker, and the material is laid down, and 2 to 3 kgs from each of these laid down material is taken and fed to the hopper feeders, and this is how mixing is done. So this was the conventional method of doing it. And let us go to another method in bale mixing, that is at the bale stage. Another one was stack mixing or blending. So in this method, the blend components from the bale breaker are weighed and laid down in alternate layers about 15 centimeters thick, covering up to 40 square meters. So what is done is, if there are three components that are shown here, they are laid in layers like this, one, two, three, and if needed, a static anti-static solution sprayed on each layer of fibers that may be prone to static generation. If there is any fiber which there are chances of static generation, then anti-static solution is sprayed at this stage, and the stack is generally laid up to a height of 3 meters, and the fibers are withdrawn vertically for feeding. So this stacks are laid one on top of the other like this, and normally when we withdraw the fibers or when fibers are being fed to the hopper feeder, in that case a vertical section is taken, and it is like this, a vertical section is taken, and one can see now if we were to take this vertical section, we would get layers from each of this together, and this itself will lead to a good kind of blending. And then when we take a next section, it will be similar section after this, so which will be representing all the three layers over here. Maybe the first layer is coming from a different region, the second one is coming from a different source altogether. So these may, one can say if there are three different cottons from three different regions, when we take a vertical cross section over here, we are getting a piece of each one of these fibers that we are going to mix. So this is one good way of doing blending at the bale stage. So, and with this, we come to the flock blending, again done at the blow room itself. The first one we saw in detail at the bale stage. Now we look at flock stage blending in case of blow room. Flock blending means blending at a stage where the flocks are smaller as compared to the mixing at bale mixing. At bale mixing stage, the size of the material that we are feeding to the upper feeder is quite large. But when it comes to flock feeding, the flocks are smaller in size. This method has the same advantages and disadvantages of bale mixing, since this method is also an uncontrolled type of blending. But there is a possibility of metering in this kind of type of blending, and it improves both the longitudinal as well as transverse blending. Some amount of controlled flock feeding is possible at the conventional weighing hopper and blending machine. So some of the hopper feeders in case of conventional would have a weighing system where one can weigh and feed the material. So in that case, one could expect a little bit of better blending that would happen. So flock blending gives an improved blend if carried out just before the card, since we are going to reduce the subsequent rolling. Suppose the in case of bale mixing, what happens is we are trying to blend at the first stage itself, and therefore whatever machines follow after hopper feeder, for example, it might be AxiFlow or it might be any kind of machine that will follow. In the conventional, it could be a step cleaner, then maybe different Crichton openers and so on, which was there. Then there was Kirshner beater. So all the rolling action that they were subjected to, one can expect deblending to take place over there. So if we are doing this flock blending, which is carried out just before card, which is the final stage of blow room, then in that case, we would be eliminating a lot of rolling action, and therefore there are reduced chances of deblending. The use of automatic bale openers have encouraged the use of flock blending. Today, we have already seen the modern bale openers. They reduce the flock size just at the stage one itself, and such kind of flock opening, small size of flocks that we can create at the first stage itself, have encouraged the use of flock blending. So with this, we are at a stage where we can go for lap blending at blow room, and we can take a look at this. Lap blending was carried out at Scutcher, which was the last stage for producing a lap in the conventional blow room line. So in the conventional blow room line, the last machine that one would see was a Scutcher, where the lap was produced. Blending was carried out when the material is in the form of a lap. So we have earlier seen when blending is taking place in the when the material is in the form of a bale. Then we saw blending where material is in the form of small flocks, that is just before card. And now we are seeing blending in blow room if the material is in the form of a lap. So this was the conventional method. This is Scutcher. And one can see here laps for blending are laid one after the other, and the laps would be opened out on a conveyor lattice over here, which would be then fed to a beater. And after beating, the whatever blending is happening over here, it would be passed over cages for removal of any kind of trash or impurities by using suction over here, and then it would go to a lap winding device. This method allows for a high degree of flexibility in operation with a variety of feed materials. That means one can use any kind of material over here. Lap 1 could be a different material, 2 are different, and so on. So there is a lot of flexibility in operation in terms of variety of feed material that one can have. However, it is uneconomical and also complicated due to the additional stage and the requirement of a doubling Scutcher. So lap blending produces a very good transverse and also a good longitudinal blend due to the exclusion of subsequent rolling. Again, one must observe here that since this is the last stage, subsequent rolling has been minimized, and again it would not result in deblending, which would have otherwise happened in case of bale mixing when we are mixing fibers at the bale level. So these are the types of blending at the blowroom stage. We have seen at bale level, at flock level, and at lap level. So there is another kind of blending that could happen at the card, which is at a later stage. So let us take a look at it. The most intimate blend is obtained if the individual fibers are brought together. Instead of bringing flocks together, if we were to bring individual fibers together, it would give a better blend. And in that case, this can only be achieved at the card and also in the case of rotor spinning. However, controlled metered blending cannot be carried out on these machines. At card stage, one cannot have a controlled or a metered blending. So therefore, one cannot expect a good composition or a ratio of blend. But these machines definitely, whether it is card or whether it is rotor spinning, which is an alternative spinning system, both these kind of blending taking place at both these machines will definitely make the previously blended material more intimate, because in this both these machines, the fibers tend to be individualized, or rather fibers blend at the individual fiber level. So one could expect a more intimate blend. So with this, we have seen bale mixing, we have seen fiber blending at card. Now we shall look at sliver blending. That is, once the sliver is made, one can also blend at draw frame level. So at draw frame level, blending of natural man-made fibers can easily be carried out in a sliver form, which would give an unsatisfactory longitudinal blend in case of bale mixing. In case of draw frame mixing, we see a good longitudinal blend, but which is an advantage over the bale mixing kind, which would give us a very poor longitudinal blend. So in case of draw frame, it is a good thing. We can carry out the blending at the sliver form. But this method, when it provides a best, provides our best longitudinal blend. But at the same time, this kind of a system might lead to a poor transverse blend, which we shall see. In this method, each raw material is processed separately on the machines best suited to it. This is the advantage, that each material can be processed separately through the line up to draw frame, and then they can be mixed. But an additional draw frame is required, which is just inserted just before the two usual breaker and finisher draw frames. So if we assume an equal hang for a 6733 blend, one can say that four slivers of one component are fed with two slivers of the other component, and one can surely get a 6733 blend at the output. But the disadvantage in this case is the requirement of a third draw frame and poor transverse blend. Although a draw frame blending gives a good longitudinal blend, unlike bale mixing, one will find that the transverse blend is very poor. Since there are no machines after draw frame. After draw frame, if we are going to produce the yarn, we have only speed frame and ring frame that will come after it, and they would not perform any further blending. Hence, the individual components do not get a chance to mingle with each other, and therefore may remain as adjacent fibers in the yarn, resulting in stripiness in the finished fabric. So again, this draw frame sliver blending will have its own advantage in terms of longitudinal blend, giving it a best longitudinal blend, but at the same time the transverse blend would be very, very poor. So with this, we come to another form of blending, which is done in the form of web blending. For this, blending draw frames were developed, and a blending draw frame brings together components in the controlled manner in a web form. So this is a draw frame or a blending draw frame, where material is taken right out of the front roller delivery, and whatever material comes out of the front roller delivery of each drafting system of the draw frames, they are taken as a web, and they are stacked on one on top of the other, and we get a blended sliver. So this is blending in the web form at the draw frame stage. It is done after the material is delivered from the front roller of the drafting system on a draw frame, just before the formation of the sliver. So this method gives a good longitudinal blend and also a slightly improved transverse blend as compared to the earlier sliver blending that we have just seen. However, it involves higher costs and more effort in maintenance as well as adjustment. Because of this involvement of this machine, it will incur higher cost and also maintenance as well as adjustment costs that would go into running this machine. So with this, we have seen the four types of blending. then we shall see another blending which is done at the roving stage and it is done at ring frame. So this method of blending two rovings at the ring frame stage is not very common. It is not used commonly for blending in case of short staple spinning mills, since the fibers do not blend in a drafting system. We have seen that at draw frame itself, it is very difficult to blend them. So it becomes more difficult if you try to blend two materials at the drafting system of the final, that is a ring frame level, by using two different rovings. So it is hardly used, because after you take rovings, two different rovings at the ring frame, the only chance for it to blend would be at the final drafting system of the ring frame, which is which does not happen because the material that comes out of the front roller is directly twisted after drafting. So roving blending is mostly used in the process of wool spinning. Two different colored rovings may be fed to the ring frame to produce a yarn that exhibits either one of the color predominates over the other color over short lengths of yarn. So if two rovings of different colors are used, then they could in fact remain adjacent to each other, those fibers in their individual capacities, but because of their two different colors, they would just intermingle with each other a little bit, and one color would predominate for a short period, and after some length the other color would be predominant. So you get a interesting fancy kind of a yarn that is produced here, and is called as a jaspi yarn. And this is the kind of yarn that one can expect with interesting colors, color patterns. So with this, we have seen all the types of blending at blow room. There are three types: at bale level, flock level, as well as lap level. After blow room, we can also have a blending at the card. One can have blending at draw frame as well, or one can have a blending draw frame specially made in the made for blending. Or if we do not want really a homogeneous mix, but we just are looking for a fancy effect in the yarn, then we can do the blending at roving stage also. So with this, we come to the summary of this particular lecture. Each of the various blending methods discussed have their own advantages and disadvantages with respect to capital cost, labor intensiveness, precision of blending, liability to error, and simplicity. So each one is different, and each one will have its advantages as well as disadvantages. Therefore, the method that needs to be used must be selected as per the requirement and the raw material to be mixed or blended. One must always decide depending on the raw material that one has, as well as the need or the requirement of the final product, to go for which kind of type of blending one needs to go for has to be decided on these factors. So there cannot be a standard method that can be used. So one has to always rely upon the raw material available as well as the requirement of the finished product. So with this, we come to the end of the lecture. Thank you.